Madam Speaker, I have a few questions for my colleagues. What if our foreign policy of the past century is deeply flawed and has not served our national security interests? What if we wake up one day and realize that the terrorist threat is a predictable consequence of our meddling in the affairs of others and has nothing to do with us being free and prosperous? What if propping up repressive regimes in the Middle East endangers both the United States and Israel? What if occupying countries like Iraq and Afghanistan and bombing Pakistan is directly related to the hatred directed toward us? What if someday it dawns on us that losing over 5,000 American military personnel in the Middle East since 9/11 is not a fair trade-off for the loss of nearly 3,000 American citizens, no matter how many Iraqi, Pakistani, and Afghan people are killed or displaced? What if we finally decide that torture, even if called enhanced interrogation technique, is self-destructive and produces no useful information, and that contracting it out to a third world nation is just as evil? What if it is finally realized that war and military spending is always destructive to the economy? What if all wartime spending is paid for through the deceitful and evil process of inflating and borrowing? What if we finally see that wartime conditions always undermine personal liberty? What if conservatives who preach small government wake up and realize that our interventionist foreign policy provides the greatest incentive to expand the government? What if conservatives understood once again that their only logical position is to reject military intervention and managing an empire throughout the world? What if the American people woke up and understood that the official reasons for going to war are almost always based on lies and promoted by war propaganda in order to serve special interests? What if we as a nation came to realize that the quest for empire eventually destroys all great nations? What if Obama has no intention of leaving Iraq? What if a military draft is being planned for the wars that will spread if our foreign policy is not changed? What if the American people learn the truth, that our foreign policy has nothing to do with national security, that it never changes from one administration to the next? What if war and preparation for war is a racket serving the special interests? What if President Obama is completely wrong about Afghanistan and turns out worse than Iraq and Vietnam put together? What if Christianity actually teaches peace and not preventive wars of aggression? What if diplomacy is found to be superior to bombs and bribes in protecting America? What happens if my concerns are completely unfounded? Nothing. But what happens if my concerns are justified and ignored? Nothing good. And I yield back the balance of my time.
The football stadium seats about 80,000 people. Only problem, Romney had about 1,000 people in the crowd, making the event look like a total flop.
I guess we had a hard time finding a large enough place to meet, and this certainly is.
Romney's campaign couldn't even fill all the chairs in the audience.
Ron Paul appeared before an enthusiastic crowd, and many in the crowd were young.
But he is the only one who can win against Barack Obama. He's the only one with appeal to the moderates and independents. He's the only one widely supported by our troops. And he's the only one with the army of young supporters needed to win.
The thought that the Iranians could pose an imminent attack on the United States is preposterous. There's no way. This is just
an attack. This is just
war propaganda. Continued war propaganda, preparing this nation to go to war and spread this war not only in Iraq but into Iran unconstitutionally. It is a road to disaster for us as a nation. It's a road to our financial disaster if we don't read the Constitution once.
Around the horn, Congressman.
A new CNN poll out today shows the Texas congressman in a statistical tie with President Obama if they were to face off in the general election today. Now, this is pretty amazing. It comes after Paul finished a strong second in New Hampshire last week.
Ron Paul, not going anywhere. Ideologically pure and tough as nails.
You know, some Republicans out there have been saying that Ron Paul would be very dangerous for this country because he wants to bring troops like you back from your posts from all over the world.
Well, I think it would be even more dangerous to start nitpicking wars with other countries. Someone like Iran, Israel is more than capable.
All right, we just lost our tech connection, unfortunately, with Dana. Dana, stand by if you can hear me. We're going to get back. You want to go to Candy Crowley over at Mitt Romney headquarters. People are beginning to fill up that room over there, Candy.
I mean, if you look, somebody told me, you know, from this last debate, I thought I did rather well. And they went down the number of times they mentioned the other three candidates in the review of the debate. And it was, you know, like 80, 90 times, depending on which it was. I was mentioned one time in all the discussion of the debate after it was over.
Right.
Now, you might argue I didn't win, or some people argue that
I did. You had the juice.
But I deserve more than one mention on all the stations. Somebody went and added these all up.
Thank you, Congressman.
So what's going on here? You're in this
here.
Media business.
Thank
I'd like
you.
To know exactly how that comes about.
I had a printout of how many hours.
So now with Pelini dropping out, Rick Perry dropping in, and Michelle Bachmann and Ron Paul dominating the Ames straw poll, we got ourselves a race.
We have a top tier. It is Mitt Romney, Rick Perry, and Michelle Bachmann.
We have a new top tier, and it's Perry, Mitt Romney, and Bachmann.
There's now a top tier in this race, at least for now, of Romney, Perry, and Bachmann.
I mean, I think that's fair to say.
Really fair to say? You're not forgetting, I don't know, anyone, say, an ideologically consistent 12-term congressman who came within less than 200 votes of winning the straw poll? Isn't anyone going to give that gentleman a little love?
There's a top tier now of Bachmann and Perry and Romney, and, you know, we haven't mentioned, and we should.
Thank you.
We haven't mentioned, and we should, Rick Santorum, who did really surprisingly well for the amount of money and resources he had.
And by the way, this pretending Ron Paul doesn't exist for some reason has been going on for weeks.
A new Gallup survey showing Rick Perry running second to Mitt Romney, knocking down Iowa favorite Michelle Bachmann to fourth.
Behind who? Fourth behind who? How did libertarian Ron Paul become the 13th floor in a hotel? What's wrong with, he is Tea Party patient zero. All that small government grassroots business, he planted that grass. These other folks, they're just moral majorities in a tri-cornered hat. Ron Paul's the real deal, and Fox News should love this guy. And even when the media does remember Ron Paul, it's only to reassure themselves how there's no need to remember Ron Paul.
Right now, live, right next to the bus behind us, Ron Paul is speaking. And seven of the candidates are here today. We have live pictures of Ron Paul, but you know what? We're talking about Sarah Palin, and we're talking about Rick Perry, the two people not in the race yet, Drew.
And guess what, Paul? If you get video of Sarah Palin or get a soundbite from her, bring that back to us. You can hold the Ron Paul stuff. Okay, let's look at the numbers. Here are the favorable unfavorables right now on the Republican frontrunners. Gingrich, 63% unfavorable, 25% favorable. Look at that spread. Romney, 54% unfavorable, 34% favorable, 20-point spread there. Santorum, he's relatively okay. 38% unfavorable, 32% favorable. He at least, well, he doesn't have a positive, but he does have a bad negative.
That's pre-kitchen sink.
Move on. Let's take another question. Congressman, I'll bring you in on this one. Let's take a question now from social media. Question. Before we move on, you want in on this issue? They want you in on this issue. Would you like in on this issue?
John, once again, it's a medical subject and I'm a doctor, you know.
Been answering a lot of questions lately about the newsletters that were published under your name, and some of the things contained in them were conspiracy theories. Some of them are considered racist, and you've disavowed them completely. But they were called the Ron Paul Report. And did you read them at all when they were published during those years? Did you ever sort of take a look at it and say, you know what, this isn't what I stand for?
Not all the time.
But you did read them.
Not all the time.
Well,
on occasion, yes.
And did you ever object when you read them?
Well, you know, we talked about this twice yesterday. Has CNN have? Why don't you go back and look at what I said yesterday on CNN and what I've said for 20-some years? Is 22 years ago? I didn't write them. I disavow them. That's it. I never read that stuff. I've never read it. I was probably aware of it 10 years after it was written. And it's been going on 20 years that people have pestered me about this, and CNN does it every single time. So
well,
when are you going to wear yourself out?
I mean,
out?
Wouldn't you say it's... No, but...
When are you going to do that?
Is it legitimate? I mean, is it a legitimate question to ask that something went out
and when you get
your
the
name?
You get the answer, it's legitimate that you sort of take the answers I get. You know what? The answer is, I didn't write them. I didn't read them at the time, and I disavow them. That is the answer.
Well, it's just a question. I mean, it's legitimate. It's legitimate. These things are pretty incendiary, you know.
Because of people like you.
No. Come on. Some of the stuff was very incendiary, and you know, saying that in 1993 the Israelis were responsible for the bombing of the World Trade Center, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
So.
Caucuses, winning the Republican nomination, or winning the presidency. So we're going to ignore it.
dollars in second. Well, you know why? Ron Paul.
What do you think that is? I think it's two things. I think one is some people don't want to hear the message because it's a threat to them, because I'm a threat to the establishment. Some, though, just flat out, they don't understand what freedom is all about.
Is Ron Paul being ignored by the media? 97% of you said yes, he is. 3% said no.
Ron Paul makes a lot of sense, and more people ought to listen to him.
But is there a media bias against him? Just from the media's point of view, isn't he good for the media?
It's because he is such an extraordinary candidate that the mainstream media doesn't pay attention.
There is one candidate who has been largely ignored by the mainstream media. Shame on us. He deserves more attention from us than he's getting.
Congressman, your libertarian views are certainly somewhat unconventional, but they have picked up growing support in this race.
I'm fascinated with your word unconventional. Isn't it strange that we can apply that term to freedom and liberty and the Constitution, limited government, it's a balanced budget? You're proposing this unconventional idea of government. Yeah, it's time we quit this. It's time. It's trillions of dollars we're spending on these wars.
Another question. Mr. Paul, why is the media ignoring you to the extent to not mention you at number two in the poll? They mentioned number one and three. Why?
Good question. I don't know if I have the answer, because we have to ask those who do those kind of things. I believe personally that I am gaining recognition in the campaign, and it's a threat to a lot of people. It's a threat to the military-industrial complex. It's a threat to the bankers, the big corporations who get all the benefit. It's a threat to the people who preach that we have to be in the world and be in all these countries. So I think it's big banks, big money, big corporations, and the people who want to be the warmongers. If our views, you know, keep growing in popularity as they are, it's a real threat to the establishment. So the establishment is well protected in many of those individuals that control the five major networks.
Well, it seems the mass media has officially given up on one Republican presidential candidate, Ron Paul, who has consistently attracted a very passionate and dedicated following, reportedly has had only one embedded reporter throughout the entire campaign. And now he apparently has none, because MSNBC pulled the sole embed off the bus. And this proves that for mainstream reporters, Ron Paul just isn't worth their time. Now, when you see video of Paul, he usually is swarmed with a very energized fan base, yet he hasn't won a single caucus yet. And this has the candidate raising suspicion.
Because sometimes we get thousands of people like this, and we'll take them to the polling booth, and we won't win the caucus. So, you know, a lot of our supporters are very suspicious about it. But the straw votes have been very confusing. I mean, you probably read in the paper about what happened up in Maine. I mean, there's just a lot of confusion. They said, well, let's have a recount. They said, well, we can't have a recount. They just write these numbers down on a piece of the paper, and we throw them away afterwards. So it's that kind of stuff that makes you suspicious.
Tonight, Maine's Republican Party announced Mitt Romney as the winner of their caucuses.
That winner is Mitt Romney.
What the headlines haven't told you is that what happened in Maine is the messiest caucus Republicans have had so far.
Certain residents in three of Maine's counties are being treated right now as if they do not exist.
The numbers that the state GOP in Maine are reporting are, according to caucus chairman, incorrect.
Kennebec County did vote as they were supposed to last week, but their vote total, as you see here, shows up as a zero in the Republican Party's official results. Washington County postponed their caucuses on Saturday because of a snowstorm they expected to hit the area.
There's a lot more than what you said. The man who canceled it was a Mitt Romney supporter, and the snowstorm he predicted didn't happen.
Then there's Waldo County. Even though nearly all Waldo County towns held caucuses on February 4th, here's how most of Waldo County County's votes. Look, look in the official Republican Party's results list. Zero votes.
Waldo County, where voters from 18 towns gathered for municipal caucuses. I talked with Matt McDonald, a pastor of a small community church in Belfast. He was nominated as the chairman of the Belfast caucus. The state instructed the chairman to not read any of the votes aloud, and instead to send them directly to Augusta. McDonald made a motion to have the votes read aloud at the caucus, and it passed unanimously.
The vote was 8 for Ron Paul, 7 for Rick Santorum, 5 for Mitt Romney, and there were 2 undecideds.
No results have been posted from the Belfast caucus.
The lady on the line said that she had received our tallies, our votes, but hadn't recorded them online yet, and she said Romney with 9, Rick Santorum with 5, Ron Paul with 2. Well, of course, those were not the right numbers, and I told her. And she said, well, those are the numbers we have.
You see, dozens of towns on the GOP site are listed as if no one voted, including in Waterville, Maine, home to 15,000 people.
We contacted the Maine Republican Party today to find out what the heck happened to all of Waldo County's votes. So far, we have not heard back. The margin of victory for Mitt Romney in Maine was 194 votes. That's called a hair.
On every occasion, the votes that were lost were Ron Paul votes. In one case, the votes were actually transferred from paper to electronics, and the lady doing the transfer was a Mitt Romney person.
Remember what the establishment said about Reagan? He's radical and out of touch and dangerous. It's the same thing the establishment now says about Ron Paul. What's so dangerous about him? He wants a return to the Constitution. And though the Constitution is our founding document and embodies our first principles of limited government, sound money, and personal freedom, we've drifted so far from it that a return to those principles would indeed mean substantive change to the government. The only danger Ron Paul represents is to the establishment that fears its own loss of power. We've drifted so far, drowned so deep in debt, lost so many of our rights, fought so many fruitless wars, that if we don't rock the boat now, we may end up sinking.
What's your plan for tonight?
Tell the truth.
I've been in politics for 35 years. My cause has been the cause of liberty.